Hello and welcome to LA Currents. I'm Anita Bennett. Well, he's been described as a tireless public servant and a beacon of hope. But after nearly two decades, Reverend Andy Bales is stepping down as president and CEO of the Union Rescue Mission. Joining us today is Reverend Andy Bales in his own turf here at the Union Rescue Mission. Thank you so much for letting us come in here. And we want to talk about what's next for you. So what is next?
What's next is I leave here about December 31st. I have a lot of work to do between now and December 31st. And then I leave and start work in an inner city program adjacent to the most impoverished school in Des Moines, Iowa, in an education and feeding program for elementary kids called CFUMS, Children, Families, Urban Movement in Des Moines, Iowa. So I'm looking forward to helping the kids. Mm-hmm. But my wife made the decision for me. She said, last year, she said, after your next birthday, which is coming up October 26th, she said, I'm moving back to Iowa to hang out with our redheaded grandgirls, and you can join me if you'd like. And I kind of gulped and thought, uh-oh, I'm in trouble. And so I'm being obedient to my wife, and my heart will always be here.
Wow.
At Union Rescue.
So the wife made the decision, but you're going to be doing the same type of work, correct?
Well, I'll be working with young children and their families, hoping to keep them, I guess, out of homelessness, but more importantly, help them become very successful adults who never have to consider homelessness, and help them get into college or specialized training. I often say, if you want to make sure you never come to the mission, you know, speaking to young people, get either a high school graduation and specialized training or a college degree, and don't pick up a bad habit along the way. Because if you do, if you drop out of high school, don't get specialized training and pick up a bad habit, I might see you at the mission someday. So please avoid coming to the mission. So I guess I'll be more in the preventative work.
Well, you've been redirecting traffic on Skid Row for over 18 years. Was it a difficult decision to leave?
Yes, I would never have made the decision to leave. My wife made it for me. So I was heartbroken. I even tried to stall a little bit. I had a different perspective in mind, two or three more years. Mm-hmm. I kind of knew it was coming, and I kept trying to avoid the subject. But when she laid down the law, I had to alert our board. So they've started a search. Working with Carter Baldwin, a search firm, and they've been searching since a couple months ago. And I guess the first candidates will come in end of September, early October, and I'll be getting ready to trade offices with them and assist them until I leave December 31st.
Are the candidates all from Los Angeles County?
No, it's a nationwide search, so people could be coming in from anywhere.
I mean, how do we ensure that the people know some of the unique problems here in Los Angeles?
Yeah, I think anybody they draw from will be a follower of what we do here at Union Rescue Mission, and hopefully connected with me and others on the team in some way. Mm-hmm. And definitely will have to be very interested in coming to what is the worst man-made disaster in the United States. There's no doubt that Skid Row, with almost 5,000 people on the streets, the most violent neighborhood in the United States, according to Forbes magazine, they will have to feel a severe call to come and serve here. And I think what our board will be looking for the most is a passion for people devastated by homelessness. And in our case, as a faith-based mission, a heart for serving God. And hopefully they'll be a relentless advocate for people devastated by homelessness.
We're going to get back to the violence and the drug problems here on Skid Row. But I want to know, the new candidate, are you going to work with them? Is there a transitional period?
Yes, that's the idea. They'll come in perhaps by October or November, and I'll stay until December 31st and spend some time daily with them and introduce them to people, introduce them to friends of the mission, introduce them on the streets and welcome them and give them all the support I can. And I'll continue to be a friend and a contributor to Union Rescue Mission for rest of my life.
So you'll come back?
I'll visit. If they ever ask me back, I'll come back.
All right.
And I'll be a faithful hero for Hope and contributor every month.
Okay. Hero for Hope, that is financial contributions.
Yes.
Okay. You have had some health challenges as a result of the work that you've done here. You had one leg amputated. Can you tell us about that?
Yes. I knew when I came here that my kidney was wearing out. And in 2010, I started having kidney failure. 2012, I had a quadruple bypass on my heart, and which wiped out my kidney function. And then my wife stepped forward. That's kind of why I listened to her. She stepped forward and gave me a kidney, donated her kidney, kept me alive. On Valentine's Day, February of 2013, so more than 10 years ago. And I knew I'd always be susceptible to things after that. When you have a transplant, you're susceptible. And I happened to have a blister. It was actually from walking so much at the hospital. And then I did a triathlon 5 weeks after getting out of the hospital, and I got a blister on my foot, which turned into a wound, which started to heal, but I was wearing a wound boot and came in contact with human waste out on the streets doing a water walk. And I got three flesh-eating diseases, E. coli, staph, and strep, flesh-eating diseases.
The trifecta.
And so I went to the hospital with 104 temperature, blood poisoning, big blood blisters, and then it became gaping holes. And it lasted about 2 years of trying to hang on to my foot, but I ended up losing it. And then for about 6 or 7 years, I tried to get around with one leg and missing the other. And that wore the other leg out. So I've lost both legs now, and I have two prosthetic legs. But I've had some challenges. Those are a couple. But I've continued to get back. I set a world record for coming back to work after a kidney transplant. 3 weeks after I got the kidney transplant, I came back to work. I've continued to work throughout all the challenges. Even when I was on dialysis 4.5 months, I worked, and I would take the time in dialysis to send love notes to our donors and let them know how much I appreciated their support.
Wow, and you set a world record. You're being facetious, right?
No, or I set a world
Guinness,
record.
Guinness, really?
Yeah, so the world, normally it's 3 months to return after a kidney transplant. I think the record before me was 6 weeks, but I returned in 3 weeks because I wanted to get back to work. I get to come here to the Union Rescue Mission and see walking miracles happen every day. So that's why I wanted to get back to work.
You were definitely dedicated to the mission.
Thanks.
With everything that's happened, do you have any regrets?
I have regrets that things are worse on Skid Row than when I came. I thought I could, with the help of our community and with God's help, we could end Skid Row as we know it and make sure there wasn't one precious soul lost on our streets. And instead, not only did Skid Row get much worse, but homelessness spread to every neighborhood in Los Angeles, mostly due to bad policy by our federal government, our state government, our county government, our city government. But a lot of it was due to what I think is our society kind of losing its moorings. People are losing touch with traditions that kept them healthy and whole. They're losing touch with family. And I found in a study I did for Iowa State University 30 years ago that the biggest common denominator among people devastated by homelessness, not the cause, but the biggest common denominator, is losing touch with family. So family disintegrates when they're young, or they burn every bridge with their family, and that's the biggest common denominator, and that's happening more and more, unfortunately. And also growing mental health issues, especially since the pandemic, and addiction problems. In the world, addiction's up like 43%. In the world, addiction is up 43%. Yeah. And the use of hard drugs is up 25% in the world. And women and men, we used to be different. Men used to drink 3 times the hard liquor that women used to. Now it's equal. So people are, instead of turning to community and family and church and faith communities for help, they're escaping reality with addiction. And I think it's a combination of all of that and more.
You mentioned policies. What are some of those policies that you think have led to this crisis?
Well, 10 years ago, I cried out, please don't go to the harm reduction Housing First policy. The proposal was to build very expensive, slow to develop units for a few while we leave the many out on the streets. But everybody, you know, this is the new flavor of the month. Everybody shifted away from emergency shelter and interim shelter and transitional housing and recovery. And they said, you archaic missions, you used to, and recovery people used to manage this problem. We're going to solve it. And so they proposed over 10 years ago, building units.
Who is they?
Just proponents of the Housing First harm reduction model. And it started in the George Bush years with Philip Mangano and others. And then it, Barack Obama, President Barack Obama adopted it wholesale. And our community here fought for it. And the permanent supportive housing people used to tell me, we're going to put you out of business. That's what they used to tell us.
Wow.
And so they moved ahead, right? Funders shifted their funding. Foundations shifted their giving. Churches even called me before them, whole denominations, and had meetings. Are we going to stick with supporting places like Union Rescue Mission? Or are we going to support the Housing First? And millions of dollars shifted, and yet we continued to continue to do what we do, 24/7 welcoming shelter, transitional housing, recovery, and even, you know, Dr. Valicia Adams-Kellum with LASA, she says that move harmed a lot of good transitional housing and recovery programs when we did it. Well, I cried against it before it came. I fought against it the whole time it's been here. And now, unfortunately, I'm having to say, I told you so. The numbers don't lie. We have more people devastated by homelessness than we've ever had. Street homelessness has skyrocketed as we went to the housing a few and leaving the many on the streets. Chronic homelessness, the people we were directing that help to, actually didn't go down, it rose. And numbers don't lie. And the most accurate, unfortunate barometer is that 6 people per day are now dying of complications of homelessness in LA. And that's up from 2 or 3. When it was 2 or 3 per day, that was alarming. But now it's at an all-time high. People on the street are at an all-time high. It's time to say, this has failed. Let's try something else.
So you say Housing First should not be the first issue. So what should it be?
It should be a multiple strategies, a both and. So our wonderful new mayor, Karen Bass, it's so nice to have her on board, because she's saying we need a both and approach. We need a vast network of interim housing immediately to get people off the streets while we build housing. I would add to that, while we build innovative, immediate, affordable housing that can go up not in a matter of 4 years like the Housing First currently is doing, but in a matter of days and weeks and months. I've proposed before mobile homes, brand new 3-bedroom, 2-bath mobile homes to our governor when he was spending billions. He could have
built. Which governor?
Governor Gavin Newsom.
Okay.
He, for the same billions, he could have built 180,000 brand new mobile homes, which would have housed every homeless person in the United States, let alone California. But that's not what we did. We doubled down on the very expensive, slow to develop housing. But now there's 3D printed concrete homes for $82,000 for a 2-bedroom, 2-bath unit. There's container homes for $100,000 that you can build. There's prefab homes that you can do affordably. My son has a yurt in his backyard that's $45,000. There are creative housing options that we could do, and I would propose that we place them in recovery villages rather than allowing them currently to have the harm reduction model, the free flow of hard drugs, and ruled by gang rule. That's what's happening in the housing around us. And why are we adding more units when 50% of the units on Skid Row are currently vacant because of the violence? And people don't want to live on Skid Row because it's so violent. And people don't want to live in the permanent supportive housing because it's so violent. Mm-hmm. So why not do a different option? I've been going to Washington, D.C. and speaking up for something called Housing Plus.
Housing Plus.
30% of federal money that's currently going to Housing First harm reduction would be moved to go to recovery units. I've always longed for Union Rescue Mission to create places for people to move that are affordable and sober and safe and peaceful. I guess that's my other regret, that I was not able to convince our board of directors to move not just the emergency, transitional, recovery, and permanent supportive housing, the sober version, but that I wasn't able to create affordable housing in recovery options. Mm-hmm. And perhaps with Housing Plus, if it passes, Union Rescue Mission could step up and do some of that affordable, sober recovery housing.
We have seen a growing amount of transitional housing, the tiny home villages,
yes,
which has gone up.
Absolutely.
They've gone up around the city. I mean, what are your thoughts on that?
Well, they're not big enough, right? 64 square feet, sometimes shared by two people, isn't big enough to be sustainable. Mm-hmm. We need more like 300 square foot with a bathroom and a kitchen. Someone could live in that for a lengthy time and have good mental health. But 64 square feet, although it's better than the streets, it's not the best option, in my opinion. That's why we haven't gotten into the tiny house as it is movement. But we are looking to do more of what I shared, the 3D printed concrete homes, mm-hmm, that are more like 600 square feet, or mobile homes or container homes or prefab homes.
Are there restrictions on how large those villages can be?
That's an interesting subject too. Our mayor is speaking about that. We need to remove the barriers and the red tape that keep possibilities like that happening, although she hasn't specifically mentioned affordable, innovative, immediate housing like I have. I'm hoping she will figure out that the very expensive, slow to develop million-dollar units that are going up in Venice are not our way out of homelessness.
So we're seeing some progress under Mayor Bass.
Yes.
You mentioned 3D printed homes.
We're working with a group from Reading that has done that already. The Woodbury University has a model that's been placed on their campus that we watched get printed and put on their campus.
Wow.
And they've been inviting us to go see this in action. And they have proposed putting 3 fourplexes up for $82,000 a unit at one of our sites, either Hope Gardens Family Center or another ranch that we're working on. And we hope to do that in the future. But we need that kind of innovation. We can't leave people on the streets to suffer and die. Mm-hmm. When 6 people are dying per day and waiting 4 years for a unit, we need explosive growth of immediate, affordable, innovative housing.
So technology could help this issue.
Technology could help us. But as our mayor says, and I like to quote her, it won't work without mental health assistance and addiction recovery programs, because currently those are missing and we're suffering because they're missing.
Okay. Let's talk about the latest homeless count. You mentioned 6 homeless residents a day are dying on the streets. The numbers, did you expect them to be as bad as they are? Because there's now 46,000 people unhoused in the city of L.A.
Yes, 46,000 unhoused in the city of L.A., 75,000 in L.A. County. That's at best a good estimate or a guesstimate. It's not a count, but it is indeed alarming, heartbreaking, because each of those numbers represents a precious human being. Mm-hmm. And it's up 10%. right?
Year over year.
Yeah, year over year, it's up 10%. In California, it's up 10%. And think about this, 50% of all street homelessness in the United States is in California. One third of all homeless people in the United States are in California. We are a disaster. And the biggest thing I thought about when I heard the count, and I was there at Lhasa listening to our mayor and others share their heartbreak, was we have to quit arrogantly thinking we're doing this right. There are other models, Houston and New York City, who are doing a much better job. We need to be humble. I'd say we need to be humiliated. I'm sometimes at my best when I've been humiliated. Then I'm willing to learn, and we need to be humble enough to learn from other cities and mm-hmm. states and how they're doing this, because we are not succeeding in LA or in California.
What we're doing is absolutely not working. What does this say about Los Angeles to the rest of the nation?
Well, it says either we don't know what in the world we're doing, or we're intentionally leaving precious human beings on our streets to die, because nobody else leaves 70% of the homeless population on the streets without taking immediate action to get them off the streets. Nobody, no other metropolis comes close to leaving 70% of the people on the streets.
So say in New York, a higher percentage of the homeless are housed, you're saying?
96% are under a roof. They have a right to shelter law, and then they have a law that if it's 32 degrees or lower, you have to come in. They make you come in. The equivalent of that in LA is 40 degrees and rain. But when all those atmospheric rivers were coming in, you remember all those reports? Do you remember any big push to get everybody in? No, and people were dying. More people die of hypothermia in Los Angeles than die in New York City or San Francisco combined, because of our sheer number of people we leave on the streets. And if it's 40 degrees and rain in LA, you have a chance of dying.
But the images that I see in the media, San Francisco looks much worse than LA.
Well, a small area of San Francisco looks like Skid Row.
Okay.
But I wouldn't say it's worse. It's just a very small focused area of San Francisco, and it's spreading, it's getting worse. Too many people, 8,000 people homeless in San Francisco in a very small area, which is really bad. But we have the equivalent on Skid Row, and unfortunately, it's spread beyond Skid Row. So we have the same, and
Venice, the San Fernando Valley, and I'm just talking about the city of LA.
Yeah, and South LA. Governor Newsom brought in the National Guard to take on the fentanyl dealers on the streets. We need the same here. I went to our authorities years ago, and I said, Huntington, West Virginia brought in the National Guard to work with the sheriff to go after the dealers, and they brought in recovery experts to work with the addicted to help them get off the streets. Why don't we take that kind of action?
So I just did an interview recently with the DEA, a member of the DEA, and they said that a lot of these dealers are coming from outside of this area because it's very lucrative. So what is law enforcement doing, in your opinion? Are they doing enough?
They're not doing enough, and our policies, unfortunately, the harm reduction policy, again, that's a misnomer, because it's the harm enhancement, in my opinion. It's the free flow of drugs. And our county is funding nonprofits that are going out and handing out meth pipes on Skid Row. So our county is supporting and sustaining the policies that support and sustain cartels. And now they want to bring a government-funded injection site to Skid Row. Talk about the keeping on the corralling containment policy of yesteryear. Mm-hmm. Bringing a injection site only, or you could call it injection site, a smoking site, whatever you want to call it. That's what they want to do on Skid Row.
To contain
now.
It, yeah.
And why in the world would we add to the misery on Skid Row? Why in the world would our tax dollars be spent in the city and county of LA to continue the misery on Skid Row?
You keep sounding these alarms, but is anyone listening?
Yes, our mayor. I have great hope in our mayor Karen Bass, she is sounding the alarm louder than I could ever. Mm-hmm. And she's saying, we can't deal with this crisis without dealing with mental health problems and issues, and without dealing with the addiction recovery. And she told me, she said, Andy, how long are you around? She came over and made a point at a public meeting on TV, said, how long are you around? I said, December 31st. So she said, you're around for a while. Let's work together to solve this. And so I have great confidence that we're going to not only bring recovery, but even faith-based recovery to this problem.
Excellent. It's too bad you won't be here to continue working with the mayor.
Yeah, but our Union Rescue Mission will.
I see. I hear a lot of children behind
me. We have so many children.
Has the number of children here grown exponentially?
We have never seen these kind of numbers. We have 900 and some family members. We have over 500 kids at all of our sites. Hope Gardens Family Center in Sylmar, Union Rescue Mission downtown, I think there's 400 family members, and there's nearly 300 at Angela's house. So overall, we have 500 kids from 0 to 18 at our three sites. We've never seen anything like it. Our gym is completely full. Our chapel is completely full. Our fourth and fifth floor is completely full.
With people living there.
And with families living there, we've set up these pod-style family units. And then Angela's house is completely full, and Hope Gardens is completely full. So we are at the brim. So while the Permanent Support of Housing is 50% vacant with chaos and drugs raining, we are over capacity because we require a sober, safe environment. People want to come to a sober, safe environment.
And they're afraid to live in this housing out here.
Yes.
How do you make the average Angeleno care? Because it seems like a lot of people, we see the homeless on the street and we just look aside, but when I see all these children, it's heartbreaking. So how do we make people care?
Well, have people come visit and see them face to face. These are people just like you and me that have struggled. Many are running from chaos at home, domestic abuse. Others just had a horrific childhood, grew up in foster care, have no connection with family whatsoever. And then we do something, we tell stories from Skid Row where we actually have people share their story on video, and then we put it out there so that people hear right from the source of how I got here and how my life has changed since coming here. I'm back in college. I'm going to get a job. I'm moving into a house. I've left the alcohol and drugs behind. And when people hear that somebody is going to turn their life around, they get excited and they support us. We're completely privately funded. We don't take any federal, state, or local funding, because if we did, we couldn't focus on recovery and sobriety and safety and peace. And so we get all privately funded. And you know, people aren't excited about paying tax dollars to sustain somebody in a tax dollar situation that's unsustainable, that costs too much to do, and then leaves them in a perpetual victimhood and survival. People want to see people bounce back, and we believe in that people can bounce back, and we see it every day.
Mm-hmm. Are you going to miss this?
I'm going to miss being a part of this and being able to do my part to make it happen. I'll just have to do what I can from a distance to help keep it going.
All right. Well, Reverend Andy Bales, thank you so much for having us here at the Union Rescue Mission. We certainly wish you the best in your future endeavors. And that is going to do it for this edition of LA Currents. I'm Anita Bennett. Thank you for watching and have a great day.